Welcome to Module 1 of CollabNet's Scrum Training Series, Introduction to Scrum. This is a brief introduction to topics that are covered in greater depth than the other modules. I'm Michael James. I help organizations do Scrum and related Agile practices. This module is subdivided into three chapters. I also recommend downloading the 6-page illustrated Scrum reference card. Scrum is a framework for dealing with complex work such as new product development. It's an alternative to traditional approaches that were more suited to manufacturing and construction. Why would you need an alternative? In the previous century, most people's work required more of a focus on execution than innovation. People with defined roles used defined models and defined best practices to execute defined plans that didn't change very quickly. Life was more predictable because we knew more about what we were trying to accomplish and how we would accomplish it. People like Henry Ford used ideas from Frederick Taylor and H.L. Gantt to do predictable or repeatable work. Today, a lot of the predictable, repeatable work is done much faster, often by machines. Things change more quickly. To stay competitive, we need to inspect and adapt more quickly and deal with greater uncertainty. A transparent framework imposing time boxes and feedback loops can help us master uncertainty. Only learning organizations will be able to keep up with the future. Scrum is a framework for learning about work and the processes we use to do it. It's an attempt to put chaos in a box, making the most of uncertainty. While it's mostly been used for developing new software products, it may be useful for other kinds of complex work. Scrum introduces feedback loops, encouraging us to inspect and adapt the product that we're building and the processes we're using to build that product. Scrum is associated with the Agile movement described at agilemanifesto.org. We value individuals and interactions over processes and tools, working software over comprehensive documentation, customer collaboration over contract negotiation, and responding to change over following a plan. This doesn't mean we don't value the things on the right. We do value the things on the left more.
The basic intent of all the Agile approaches, and they are quite similar, is an early and sustainable rate of valuable feature delivery. Early in our product development cycle, we want to see some features working rather than one huge release at the end. Ideally, we'd be able to continue incremental improvements indefinitely. Product development is ongoing with frequent releases rather than a one-shot project. Here's what Scrum is not. The attempt to use traditional Gantt ideas for developing software was first described by Dr. Winston Royce in 1970. He drew a picture, a bit like this one, showing a series of phases.
One phase connects to the next phase, connects to the next phase, and each one has a handoff. In theory, you would do all your analysis in the beginning, get that completely done, then you would start on your design, get that completely done, then start on your code, get that all the way done, and then integrate, etc. That was a nice theory about how things could work, and we suppose it could work if we had perfect knowledge in the beginning and never made mistakes along the way.
The next sentence in Dr. Winston Royce's paper, unfortunately no one read this far, said, "I believe in this concept, but the implementation described above is risky and invites failure."
The reason it fails for complex work, we rarely have perfect knowledge at the beginning. In fact, we know less about our project when we're starting out than we're ever going to know in the future. Today is the dumbest day of the rest of our project. But a plan-driven approach requires us to make our most important decisions right at the beginning when we know the least. Waterfall projects eventually descend into anarchy when the actual work finally happens with low quality and too much overtime. Scrum throws all those phases in the blender. All the ingredients are mixed into every sprint.
Instead of dividing the work into activity-specific phases, we divide it into fixed-length iterations called sprints. Every sprint contains some combination of analysis, design, actual implementation, testing, planning for the future. Maybe we'll actually be shipping or deploying more frequently.
Right from the first sprint, a Scrum team tries to build a working, tested, potentially shippable product increment, even if it starts out small. Every sprint they demonstrate what little bit of shippable product they have to everyone. Customers often need to see the wrong product before they can specify what they really need. With short iterations and more feedback, we have a better chance of discovering the right product. While the product owner doesn't actually have to ship every sprint, it's the team's job to make it possible. Sprints are officially 30 days long, and most Scrum teams are doing them in less, such as 2 weeks. To make a shippable product every 2 weeks, we're going to want people with skills in testing, in design, in business requirements, in coding, all on one cross-functional, self-organizing team. Now instead of waiting for the end to start our testing, we'll start testing with our very first sprint. Instead of doing all the design up front, we'll do a bit of design every sprint until it becomes continuous design. We'll do small amounts of continuous redesign and refactoring to avoid technical debt. Every sprint combines all aspects of the work. A Scrum team should collaborate together instead of working in phases with handoffs.
Scrum brings challenges to individuals, teams, and organizations. If it's not disrupting your organization, you're probably not doing Scrum. That's the case most of the time people claim to be doing Scrum. You usually find they've overlooked the parts of Scrum that will provide the most benefit because they are too hard to do. The purpose of Scrum's strict rules are to reveal organizational impediments that you can start fixing if you have the courage and commitment. Healing the organizational impediments exposed by trying to do Scrum is more important than, quote, doing Scrum. But this path to mastery starts with learning the framework properly. Scrum provides a structure of roles, meetings, rules, and artifacts. Let's do a quick overview of them now. There are only three roles defined by Scrum, and we'll go through each one. Product Owner, Scrum Development Team, and Scrum Master. The Product Owner is the single individual responsible for return on investment, or ROI, of the product development effort. The Product Owner mostly exerts that influence through the prioritization of the product backlog. The Product Owner is the final arbiter of requirements questions. That doesn't mean he'll give you all the detailed requirements up front, or even all the details at the beginning of every sprint, but the Product Owner does make the final call about those things. The Product Owner must have the vision behind the product development. It often doesn't make sense to make a detailed roadmap when there is high uncertainty in the future, but a vision is important. If anyone else wants anything from the team, they need to work through the Product Owner to get what they want. Sometimes we call the Product Owner the single ringable neck. He's the one person making the prioritization decisions for that team. He makes the business decisions for that team, focused more on the what than on the how. Now we have the Scrum Development Team. The Scrum Development Team is a cross-functional group responsible for self-organizing to build a potentially shippable product increment every sprint. This is hard to do in the beginning, and today more and more teams are learning how to do it. You don't want to be the last team that learns how to do this. Organizations use the word team lightly. I want you to think back to a time in your life you were on a real team where you could all count on each other. That's the kind of Scrum team I want you to create. If we keep the same team together in the right environment full-time with effective retrospectives, sprint after sprint, they'll probably get better at working with each other. They may become a learning team, the building block of a learning organization. There's no externally imposed hierarchy or job titles on this team. We leave openings for leadership to emerge naturally and for control to flow from person to person. The Scrum Development Team is a small group of people, ideally between 4 and 9 people. We have millions of years of practice dealing with groups about the size of a family. Large teams don't self-organize effectively until they've divided into smaller teams, ideally feature teams with minimal interdependencies. Team collaboration emerges most naturally in a team room. If your organization is spread around the world, you're probably already suffering poor collaboration and coordination. Scrum will quickly bring this problem to the surface. You may experience breakthroughs by getting your remote people into one room for 1 or 2 sprints in the beginning, and then every few months after that. Information sharing tools help with the practical problem of sharing information, but tools by themselves don't transform organizations. The Scrum Master is the most misunderstood role in Scrum. If I'm your Scrum Master, you're not my Scrum slave. It's the opposite. The Scrum Master has no management authority over the team. If you're the project manager or the line manager of the team, by definition, you are not the Scrum Master. Scrum intentionally leaves out the project manager role. The responsibilities of project management are split up among the product owner and the team, with the Scrum Master acting as a kind of facilitator. The Scrum Master protects the team from distractions and interruptions, gets things out of the way of natural team self-organization, removes impediments affecting the team, facilitates the process, helps teach people how to use Scrum, promotes improved engineering practices, enforces time boxes, provides visibility, and somehow does all this without any management power. How is that possible? It turns out power isn't even the most powerful type of influence. For further information on the elusive Scrum Master role, see my example Scrum Master checklist, an example list of things the Scrum Master will be concerned with fixing. The two important artifacts in Scrum are the product backlog and the sprint backlog. The product backlog is a one-dimensional, force-ranked list of customer-centric features prioritized by the product owner. It's a list of everything we might ever do. If it's not in the backlog, it doesn't exist. Anyone can add items to the product backlog, but the product owner has got to prioritize them, and the Scrum Master has got to make it visible. A well-formed product backlog does not contain tasks, only well-formed product backlog items, or PBIs, which might be written in user story form or maybe use case scenarios. Force-ranked means there's only one thing in the top position. Getting organizations to do this is usually a breakthrough. The sprint backlog is what we've committed to do right now to meet our goals for the current sprint. It has an end date. It has the committed product backlog items representing the what, and sprint tasks representing the how. Now let's have an overview of the meetings in Scrum. There are four meetings defined by Scrum, and a fifth one that just about everyone has found useful to do. The four meetings defined by Scrum, the sprint planning meeting, the daily Scrum, the sprint review meeting, and the sprint retrospective meeting. The fifth one has no official name, so we'll call it the backlog refinement meeting. Here's an example of how those meetings might fit into a two-week sprint. I personally like to end the sprint on a Friday so we don't work over the weekend. At the sprint planning meeting, the team and product owner negotiate which items will be committed to the sprint. The team pulls the top priority items from the product backlog, commits them to the sprint backlog, breaks them into smaller tasks typically, and decides whether it's the right amount of work for them to do and if they're clear about what they're going to do. They plan one sprint. During sprint execution, the team meets once per day for a 15-minute stand-up or daily scrum. If we're collaborating, we're meeting all the time, of course, but this one official meeting is defined where we stand up and report to each other. We report to each other, not to the scrum master, not to the product owner, not to any kind of boss, but to the team. I report to the six other people that are my team members. I look them in the eye and tell them what I did yesterday. Here's what I did yesterday. And I tell them what I'm going to do today. And I tell them what impedes me. What are my blockers? Then I toss the ball to someone else on my team, and they give the same report to the rest of the team. At the sprint review meeting, the team demonstrates a potentially shippable product increment to the product owner and anyone else who's interested. People are sometimes called stakeholders. The product owner will declare which items are done, which items did not meet their acceptance criteria. We can measure velocity, and we'll get feedback from stakeholders about how we're doing with that. A lot of times the feedback is, hey guys, you did what you said you'd do, but now that we see it, we realize we need something else. And we couldn't have known that until we saw the wrong product. People seem to need a piece of functioning software to react against before they can specify what they really want. Regular sprint review meetings provide a feedback loop about the product and its requirements. Every sprint ends with a sprint retrospective meeting for the team to inspect and adapt their own process. We inspect and adapt the way we worked together during the last iteration. We typically talk about what went well, what could be improved, what we learned, what still puzzles us. We give feedback to each other. These kinds of things will come up in the retrospective, and there are a lot of great techniques for doing the retrospective. This is really the key of the whole thing. The team eventually takes ownership of their own process. Regular sprint retrospectives introduce a feedback loop about the process the team uses to build the product. The fifth meeting isn't given a name officially in Scrum. I'm going to call it the backlog refinement meeting. It might also be called backlog grooming, or maybe we would do some of this work in a release planning meeting. During backlog refinement, the team and the product owner get together and they look ahead a little bit into the next few items in the product backlog, the items that are candidates for the next couple sprints. They clarify them, break the big product backlog items, or epics, into small product backlog items, or maybe user stories, so they can imagine doing a few of them in a sprint. They get some input about prioritization, they consider dependencies, those types of things. While this work could also be done in the sprint planning meeting, through experience, people have found it preferable to do it in a separate meeting on a different day. That was a brief overview of Scrum. To learn a little more about Scrum, download the Scrum reference card and the Scrum Master's checklist. To learn a lot more about Scrum, attend one of our Scrum classes or try our other training modules that go into more depth. To get coaching in Scrum or tools such as Scrumworks, Teamforge, or Subversion, give us a call here at CollabNet. Also, drop us a line to get feedback on this training module.